Hey, brothers and sisters. This is Brother Patrick, your favorite brother from another mother. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Hope you're all doing all right today. You know, let's worship the Lord a little bit. Let's praise his name. You know, lots of people, they go to church or, you know, they hear something, they just want to hear some preaching. And then other people like to praise and worship, but they don't like the preaching. But we need both, brothers and sisters. You know, when we do our praise and worship, we're ministering to the Lord. Minister means to serve. You know, we're offering up the sacrifices of praises to the Lord, as the Bible commands us to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. Then, when we hear preaching, it's the Lord is ministering to us through one of his servants. Ephesians 4:11, he gives us ministers of the gospel. Hallelujah, praise God. Praise God, brothers and sisters, that even now, even today, even though there's not that many, there are still ministers of the gospel left. Praise God. For the Lord has not left us without a witness. Hallelujah. Praise God. Lord, we enthrone you, Lord. We proclaim you our King. Standing here in the midst of us, we lift you up with our praise. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. See, the word of God says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. So as we worship him, we build his throne. Lord, we enthrone you, Lord, in our praises. He inhabits the praises of his people, the Bible says. Lord, we enthrone you, Lord. We proclaim you our King. Standing here in the midst of us. As he said in his word, he said, where two or more of you are gathered in my name, the Lord Jesus Christ said, there I am in the midst of thee. Hallelujah. That's the church. Two or more gathered in his name. It's the church, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Lord, we enthrone you, Lord. We proclaim you our King. Standing here in the midst of us, we lift you up with our praise. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. On high, hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. From on high, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into him, and they are saved. Hallelujah. Praise God. Brothers and sisters, we are saved. As that is song is also from the Bible. He is a strong tower. Hallelujah. He is our strong tower. He's the rock of our salvation. Hallelujah. Praise God. Blessed be the name of the Lord, brothers and sisters. He is our Lord and our God. Hallelujah. Mighty and holy is his name. Brothers and sisters, I beseech thee, as the King James says. I implore thee. King James words. I encourage you, I push you to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. For it's in his presence, hallelujah. In his presence, hallelujah. In his manifested presence, hallelujah. You know, God is available everywhere, always in his creation. He's omnipresent, all present, available immediately anywhere in all of the cosmos. You know, that word there when it talks about the world is creation. It's the Greek word there is cosmos. You know, we know that word too. You hear it in science. You know, it's all the creation. Hallelujah. Praise God, brothers and sisters. He's available. But the Lord responds and inhabits, it says, the praises of his people, brothers and sisters. Just like if you were to go listen to Marilyn Manson or whatever, some kind of gangster rap or country music about cheating and lying and, you know, and going to jail and all that. You know, you're inviting those demonic spirits. You're grieving the Holy Spirit and inviting demonic spirits to come towards you when you play a Ouija board, when you do tarot cards, all of those wicked things. You're inviting demons into your life. If you go to a witch doctor like we have in the Philippines, call them quack doctors here. You go to a witch doctor, you go to a seance, all of these things. You go to a psychic, all these whatever. You're inviting demonic familiar spirits into your life. But when you lift up the name of Jesus, hallelujah, when you read the Word of God, when you proclaim the Word of God, when you worship and exalt the Lord Jesus Christ, you invite the Spirit of the living God, a.k.a. the Holy Spirit, into your life, into the, around you. You invite holy angels to come near you, hallelujah. The angels of God, that's a whole other sermon. You know, angels of God, they worship God with us, hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. If you study, as a matter of fact, if you study Lucifer before the fall, you will see, and that's a whole other study too, if you would study what Lucifer did before the fall, he actually received the praises from the creation and then passed it up to the throne of God. He, in other words, he was like a choir leader, you know, in heaven, you know, between God and his creation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God, brothers and sisters, that we now through, as it says, we've been brought nigh to God by the blood of Jesus Christ. Those of us who were strangers and foreigners and, you know, Gentiles. The Hebrew word is goyim. Goy is singular, and whenever in Hebrew you have an I-M, it's plural. Goyim. We were strangers. We were foreigners. As a matter of fact, the Bible says we're enemies of God. Strangers of the covenants God had made with Israel, and lost and without hope in the world. But thanks be to God, you know, we've been brought nigh unto God by the blood of Yeshua, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise God, brothers and sisters. This is what I want to talk to you about today. You know, you hear these people who make, sometimes, it's not that big on the internet, but there's some videos about people in Christianity, the Pharisaical people. They'll tell you and talk junk about the word. They'll say about the Word of Faith movement, about Word of Faith. And the Lord just struck me with that yesterday. I wanted to make a video about it, and I want to look at Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Now, the subtopic of this section is righteousness is by faith in Christ. We know that. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. And I need to throw in verse 10, but I can't ever quote it exactly right. I've got to memorize that, Ephesians 2, 10. But verse 8 and 9 says, of Ephesians chapter 2, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. And then verse 10 goes on to say, we're saved for the purpose, I'm paraphrasing here, to do good works. God has good works predestined for us, preordained for us to do after we are saved. Okay. But what I want to hone in on here is mentally assented Christians are people who have a mental agreement with the Word of God, but not, you know, they want to eat the bread, but they don't want to have it washed down into their spirit. It's here and not here. Those who believe that God is not the same yesterday, today, and forever. Those who believe that God changed when the Bible was finished being written. That's actually what they believe. They call them cessationalists. They believe that God changed after the last apostle died and the Bible was finished being written. God doesn't move anymore. God doesn't do miracles anymore. You can't. They always say, many of those groups, they harp on having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. But yet, in that personal relationship, there's no communication other than just the Bible. Now, people who, what they want to call the Word of Faith movement, people that believe that you can communicate with God and get a response from God operating the gifts of the Spirit, like people being, you know, the gift of healing, you know, speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues, prophecy, etc., those gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12,
You know, there's 9 categories of gifts listed there. There's the little subcategories in there, you know, that I've talked about before. But anyway, the Lord just highlighted this text in my mind yesterday. So I praise God. This is the message that I want to do. Because when I started my ministry, you know, the whole foundation of the ministry that God gave me and the name of my ministry, before I changed it to Joshua's Ministry, by the Lord's leading to change it in September 2012, by the grace of God and God's leading, we changed it to Joshua's Ministry. But before that, from the time I started and got ordained in May 2001, actually I was licensed before that, so that's when I came up with the name of the ministry, when I got licensed. Say March 2001 was Walking by Faith Ministry. I didn't know that there was already another, you know, there's a television ministry called Walking by Faith, but the Lord gave me that name, so that's the name that I used all those years, like 11 years. And the ministry is Walking by Faith, and that's the foundation of the ministry that God gave me. So I haven't done a huge amount of teaching on faith, but I'll say the Lord is leading me to teach on that. So that's what I'm going to do. So, hallelujah, brothers and sisters. I stopped the video because I just feel compelled by the Lord, brothers and sisters. I've got to come back on here. I've just got to keep it simple, brothers and sisters. It's this, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by works, lest any man should boast. By grace. You know what grace is? Unmerited favor. Unearned favor. By grace are you saved through faith. What is faith? Believing something before you see it. Jesus told Doubting Thomas. When Doubting Thomas touched a hole in his side and touched a hole in his hand. And Jesus said, you have seen and now you believe. But blessed are those who have not seen yet believe. By grace, unearned favor, are you saved, delivered from death, hell, and the grave, the world, the flesh, and the devil, delivered into, you know, as the Bible says, also translated, all those things are saying here in the Bible, you are translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of his dear Son, into the kingdom of heaven, into the body of Christ, to the church of the firstborn from the dead, hallelujah, to Mount Zion, hallelujah, Hebrews chapter 12. To the multitude of angels. Hallelujah. Praise God. By grace are you saved, delivered, translated into the kingdom of his dear Son, from darkness into light. Salvation. By grace, unearned favor, are you delivered from darkness into life? Are you healed? Are you set free? Are you born again? Salvation. Deliverance. Healing. By grace are you saved through faith. Foreseen, unseen, trust, believing in advance, trusting God, accepting God's word, depending on God, unlike Eve. You know, she heard what God said. God said to Adam, and then he told Eve, don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for in that day you shall surely die. So when Eve quoted that, oh, God told us, don't touch it. He said, she even added to it, said, God, don't eat it. And God said, don't eat it or don't even touch it or you'll die. And then Satan said, and sowed the seed of doubt into the mind of Eve. And he said, did God really say, hath God said, thou shalt not surely eat of that tree? You know, thou shalt surely die. So Satan put that seed of doubt. Then he challenged it, said, no, you won't die. God doesn't want you to eat it because you will become like God. You'll become a God. Same thing the Antichrist is going to tell people. When you take the mark, you will become a God. The same thing the Mormon church teaches. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Cult, city, big time teaches that you can become a God. Jesus was a man who became a God. God the Father was a man who became God through his good works. But my Bible says, Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9, by grace are you saved through faith. Not of your own, not by works, lest any man should boast. By grace are you saved through faith, and not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by works, lest any man should boast. I should look up the text because I keep stopping in the middle of it and I have to go back and quote it from the beginning to get it right in my memory. And brothers and sisters, it's not of your own. It's not of your own. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. It's not of your own. And 10, I'm going to talk about that too as the Lord leads me. It's not of your own. It's not by the deeds of the law. For the Bible says, by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. Hallelujah. By the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. To be justified means to be right with God. To be justified is to be saved, to be counted righteous, to be considered right with God, to be delivered, to be justified. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that is not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by of works, lest any man should boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. That's the part we talk about being rapture ready. That verse 10. 8 and 9, we're talking salvation. Verse 10, we're talking about being rapture ready. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Excuse me. Which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye being in times past Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision, with flesh made by hands. It's talking about the Jews were saying Gentiles were not part of the covenant, they're going to hell. Dirty, unclean. That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens in commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants and promises, having no hope, and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, who sometimes was afar off, have made nigh by the blood of Christ. I just talked about that earlier at the beginning of this video. It's in this text. Hey, amen. For he is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us. You know, I talked about this before in videos past. That middle wall of partition that Paul's talking about is symbolized there in the temple. There's the court of the Gentiles, the court of the women, and then the court of Israel, where they could go in there and they offer sacrifices. The women were not allowed in there. And then the Gentiles had their own area. That's where Jesus, where the money changers were. And Jesus said, quoting from the Old Testament, when he cast out the money changers, he said, this house shall be called, my father's house shall be called a house of prayer. The second part of that verse says, be called a house of prayer for all nations. That's why there's a court of the Gentiles there. A house for a prayer for all nations. But there's a wall between those two courts of the Israel and the Gentiles. And that wall, you know, is symbolically there separating us. But Paul is saying that through Christ, that wall is broken down. So there's no more separation of the Gentiles and the Israelites' access to God. That's what Paul was talking about there. And then another thing, just to FYI on that, when the tribulation temple is built, when the nation of Israel now, the rabbis want to rebuild a temple because they use that verse. God's house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. So they say if we build the temple, the Messiah will come. Then all nations will come here and worship and all that. But that temple that they will build will be used by the Antichrist. And then in mid-tribulation, halfway through, he will kill the two witnesses who will be prophesying outside the temple for the first half of the tribulation. Another sign that the tribulation has begun. There will be a seven-year covenant confirmed between Israel and the Antichrist and all the other nations to rebuild the temple, to divide the land of Israel, and then the two witnesses will immediately appear there at the Temple Mount, and they'll prophesy for the whole time of the first half of the tribulation. That's how you know you're in the tribulation, for those of you who will be here. And then, mid-trib, the Antichrist will be given authority to kill the two witnesses. Well, they will lay in the street dead for 3.5 days, and they will be raptured in front of everybody. The voice from heaven will say, come up here. They will resurrect and rise up to heaven. The Antichrist, after he kills them, he will go into the temple and declare himself to be God. That is the abomination that causes desolation. He will go into the temple and set up an idol. The image of the beast will be set up in there, and he will go in there and sacrifice probably a pig on the altar, declare himself to be God. Israel will flee to Petra. And then the second half of the tribulation begins, also known as the Great Tribulation, begins in the second half. Remember, brother and sister, I didn't mean to get into that. Just giving you a little theology there. But the preaching, that's teaching, but the preaching that God wants me to do is this text right here. By grace are ye saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. It's a gift, brothers and sisters. Salvation is a gift. How can we neglect so great a salvation, as Paul also says? How can we neglect? How can anybody say no to the gospel? You know what it says? Talking about the tribulation. God is tying this in for me to give this message for those who will be left behind. Brothers and sisters, we're so close. It says in Thessalonians chapter 2, read what it says. It says that because they refuse to believe and they neglect such a great salvation, that God will send them a strong delusion, that they will believe the lie. King James says a lie, but it's in the original text, it's the lie. They shall believe the lie. What is that lie? That you can become a god. That the Antichrist is the Messiah, and that you can become like him. You can become a god, take the mark, and worship him, and you will also be a Gibborim, which is a mighty man, a Superman, a Spider-Man, like the Titans, the Clash of the Titans, and all that. You will become a Gibborim, which is the Hebrew word for a mighty man, a man of renown, a man of old, like we have the Nephilim in Genesis chapter 6, and like Nimrod, I believe that's Genesis chapter 11, when they built the Tower of Babel. One of the greatest types in the Old Testament, the tribulation, the kingdom of Antichrist, is the building of the Tower of Babel. Trying to make their own way to heaven, to make their own eternal life, through genetic modification, the mark of the beast. And that's what I hear from the Lord, brothers and sisters. The Lord is just telling me to prophesy. And the Bible says in Romans, it says, prophesy according to thy faith. Hallelujah, hallelujah, halalabasu Yahweh. Halila Moshua, halukusha baya, limoshi baya, yamashua. Hallelujah, hallelujah. My brothers and sisters, I just see this. It looks like the Sphinx, or it's an Egyptian. I think it's like the Sphinx is what I see. I see them wearing that, you know, they wear that headdress thing. It looks like a woman's hair that they wear on their head. Like even on the Sphinx. I see it, brothers and sisters. And you know, brothers and sisters, that Sphinx is facing east. Waiting for the rising of the sun of perdition. And that pyramid power represents the fall of man. It represents sacred geometry and the false, false gods of the ancient days, aka the Nephilim, the Gibborims, the Nephilims. Hallelujah, hallelujah. My Lord and my God, hallelujah. For even as the word of God says, the devil can appear as an angel of light. Such is the kingdom of Antichrist. He shall appear as an angel of light, angel of the morning, coming from the east. Therefore, God has prepared us a feast. Hallelujah. A feast for the birds and fowls of the air to consume the flesh of the wretched, wicked in the valley of judgment, in the valley of Jehoshaphat, in the valley of deception and perdition. Oh, but brothers and sisters, the Lord has prepared a table for us in the presence of our enemies. He has caused us to triumph in all things through Christ Jesus. For He has given us the victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil. and the Sodomites. Hallelujah. For he has given us this victory, Lord God. Hallelujah. 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 Even from the victory over the Jebusites, who held the high ground of the temple. For the Lord has given us the holy ground, the holy places, the sacred places. Oh, my Lord and my God, you are mighty, mighty, mighty to save, mighty in battle, mighty in victory, mighty in love, mighty, mighty, mighty is the Lord God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, deliverer, deliverer of his people from the snare of the fowler. Hallelujah. For the snare quickeneth his approach upon this land, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And ye are worthy to escape these things, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, that you may be found worthy.
All right.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, that you may be found worthy in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, I was playing some music in the background that I hadn't changed up on me there. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God Almighty. Blessed be his name. Blessed be his name. But I got a little bit disturbed when the music changed, brothers and sisters. Let me try it again. Praise God Almighty. Praise God Almighty. Blessed be the name of the Lord God. Praise God through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Lord, we exalt thee in this place, Lord. Jesus, we enthrone you, Lord. We proclaim you our King, standing here in the midst of us. We lift you up with our praise, and as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. As we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Brothers and sisters, may the Lord bless you and keep you and let his face to shine upon you and lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace and his rest by faith in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. Praise God, praise God. I'm going to be doing another video tomorrow for Sunday service on the other channel and for the website, Church of the Firstborn, for the online church. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God. God bless you all. And, you know, the Lord has given me lots of things, and I haven't really been sharing them like I used to because I only want to share them with God's people. I'm not going to, if it's up to God. I can't control who sees it, but I just want it to be the church. You know, it's for the church. It's for you as an ear to hear. It's an example. Lord, keep showing me that North Korea, it's coming, brothers and sisters. It's coming. Those of you who have been watching my channel, you know that the Lord showed me in 2011 that just at the time of the rapture, there would be a nuclear explosion on the Korean Peninsula. It's coming, brothers and sisters. It's coming so soon. Prepare your hearts and mind to meet the Lord Jesus Christ in the air. And I tell you guys this all the time. Don't worry about calculating the date, because no man knows the day or the hour. I did that for all you who use headphones. Just kidding, I did not. But it just as the Lord leads. No man knows the day or the hour, brothers and sisters. No man knows the day or the hour. I don't even want to get into it. There's a channel that was built off of that text talking about the Feast of Trumpets. But I think they've surrendered the point, because we're still here. And when the Lord says, come up here, we'll go up there. And whatever that may be. When the moment you least expect, Jesus said, in a moment you least expect, he's coming back. Matthew chapter 25, in a moment you least expect. In a moment you think not, King James, in a moment you think not, the Lord is coming for his bride in the midnight hour. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. He's coming for a church without spot or wrinkle. Therefore, Luke 21:36. Therefore, pray ye always, not one time, pray ye always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Therefore, purpose it in thy hearts, brothers and sisters, and in your minds, to be ready in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, when the trump shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, brothers and sisters. That day is nigh, even at hand. I'm telling you, by the Spirit of the living God, it's not about setting dates. It's about being ready. Those who keep trying to set dates, those who are running around accusing people of setting dates who are not setting dates, those people that are running around debating and carrying on nonsense, and trying to use their carnal mind. See, that's the thing about it. These people that have done all these charts and all that stuff. It's all right here, brothers and sisters. It's not by the Spirit of God, but by the mind of men and the imaginations of men and women. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And in that hour ye know not, but he comes at an hour you expect not. In a moment you think not, he's coming. And the question is not when, but will you be ready? Will you be ready to meet him in the air? That's the question. That's the what is it, the $64,000 question. Is, are you ready? Are you ready to meet the Lord? That's what you need to be thinking on, praying on, meditating on. Read Revelation 3:10. As Jesus tells the church at Philadelphia, because you have kept the word of my patience, or in modern English, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation to come upon the whole earth to try all the people that live on the earth. And I already quoted to you Luke 21:36, talking about tribulation. Watch therefore and pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. God bless you all, brothers and sisters. You know that I love you. Rest in Christ. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by works. You know, it's not of your own. No, anything you've done. And it's by the work of Christ alone. By grace through faith are you saved. Not by works, lest any man should boast. God bless, brothers and sisters. God bless you.